Honored guests, please welcome the Myron and Marion Kazan Director of the USC Kazan Institute and Distinguished Professor of History, Steve Ross.
Let me just get my glasses on. Good evening, everyone. welcome. My name is Steve Ross, and I am the Myron and Marion Kazan Director of the USC Kazan Institute for the Study of the Jewish Role in American Life. And on behalf of the USC Kazan Institute, it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the 40th Annual Jerome Niemer Lecture in our first Kazan event since March 2020, and the first time I have worn a tie and jacket since March 2020. So don't get too close, because it might smell of mothballs. It is very fitting that our first in-person event in over 2 years is marked by honoring the legacy of Jerry and Harriet Niemer and their daughters Janet Factor and Joan Green, whose commitment to Jewish life at USC continues to drive our vision. This year, we're particularly honored to welcome co-authors of American Shtetl, The Making of Kiryas Joel, a Hasidic Village in Upstate New York, Professors Nomi Stolzenberg, the Nathan and Lily Chappelle Chair in Law at USC's Gold School of Law, and Professor David Myers, Sally and Ludwig Kahn Chair in Jewish History at UCLA. Settled in the mid-1970s by a small contingent of Hasidic families, Kiryas Joel is an American town with few parallels in Jewish history, but many precedents among religious communities in the United States. And this book tells the story of how this group of pious, Yiddish-speaking Jews has grown to become a thriving insular enclave and a powerful local government in upstate New York. While rejecting the norms of mainstream American society, Kiryas Joel has been stunningly successful in creating a world apart by using the very instruments of secular, political, and legal power that it disavows. And I would recommend it as a wonderful read. And if you are interested, the USC bookstore has copies of the book out in the lobby, and it will be available after the lecture. Our distinguished speakers will be introduced in greater detail in a moment by Sarah Benor, Professor of Contemporary Jewish Studies at Hebrew Union College, Jewish Institute of Religion in Los Angeles, and the chair of our Niemer Committee. But I'd also like to offer Professor Stolzenberg and Myers a warm welcome and our gratitude for sharing their book with us tonight. And for those of you who may not know, not only are Nomi and David leaders in their respective fields of law and Jewish studies, but they're also pillars of the Los Angeles Jewish community, and they happen to be husband and wife. Before I begin, on behalf of the Kazan Institute, we'd like to pay homage to the memory of our esteemed colleague, Dr. Sharon Gillerman, who delivered the response to the 2019 Niemer Lecture titled In the Dark Room of Refuge and Identity that featured Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Susan Faludi. This was our last Niemer Lecture held before the pandemic, and we're honored to have featured Sharon's brilliant scholarship and vibrant presence. The USC Kazan Institute takes great pride in presenting three endowed annual lectures, which, like today's Niemer Lecture, cover a wide range of topics, from Jewish political life to Jewish scholarly and artistic contributions across America. And our two latest series, Kazan Conversations and USC Goes to Temple, aim to bring together students, faculty, and the larger community for more informal and engaging discussions that explore a wide range of contemporary topics that are at the forefront of American Jewish culture and identity. And if you haven't already done so, I invite you to join our mailing list at the Kazan Institute website. If you just type in Kazan Institute, everything you need will pop out. And at this time, mostly everything you need. At this time, I'd like to introduce my colleague, Sarah Benor, who is again our chair of the Niemer Committee, and to invite her to the podium to introduce our speakers.
Hello, everybody. You are in for a treat tonight. I get to introduce the speakers, and then you get to hear about their wonderful book. David N. Myers is Distinguished Professor of History and holds the Sadie and Ludwig Kahn Chair in Jewish History at UCLA. He has degrees from Yale University and Columbia University. He has written extensively in the fields of modern Jewish intellectual and cultural history. Among his books are Reinventing the Jewish Past, European Jewish Intellectuals and the Zionist Return to History, Between Jew and Arab, The Lost Voice of Simon Rabinovich, and Jewish History, A Very Short Introduction. His edited volumes include Eternal Dissident, Rabbi Leonard Bierman and the Radical Imperative to Think and Act, Enlightenment and Diaspora, The Armenian and Jewish Cases, and The Faith of Fallen Jews, Yosef Chaim Yerushalmi and the Writing of Jewish History. He previously served as chair of the UCLA History Department, director of the UCLA Center for Jewish Studies, and president and CEO of the Center for Jewish History in New York. Currently, he directs the Luskin Center for History and Policy and the New Initiative to Study Hate at UCLA. Nomi M. Stolzenberg holds the Nathan and Lily Chappelle Chair in Law at the USC Gould School of Law. Her research spans a range of interdisciplinary interests, including law and religion, law and liberalism, law and psychoanalysis, and law and literature. She holds degrees from Yale University and Harvard Law School. She was an editor on the Harvard Law Review and clerked for Judge John J. Gibbons of the U.S. Court of Appeals Third Circuit. Stolzenberg's scholarly publications include the frequently cited He Drew a Circle That Shut Me Out, Assimilation, Indoctrination, and the Paradox of a Liberal Education in the Harvard Law Review, The Profanity of Law in Law and the Sacred, Stanford University Press, and Writing the Relationship Between Race and Religion in Law, Oxford Journal of Legal Studies. She helped establish and co-directs the USC Center for Law, History, and Culture. Together, Nomi and David have three adult daughters and one co-authored book, which is the subject of their lecture today. The name of the book is American Shtetl, The Making of Kiryas Joel, a Hasidic Village in Upstate New York. And I invite them to the podium. You're going to hear their lecture, and then we're going to have a discussion where I'm going to ask some questions, and then there'll be time for all of you to ask questions too. Some of you to ask questions too.
Good evening, everyone. I'm just going to take the cough drop out of my mouth. I do have a cold, which I believe is not contagious since it's been with me for more than a week. I want to begin by saying how moving it is to be here as the first set of speakers after the Niemer lecture, which featured Sharon Gellerman as the respondent, whom we remember with such profundity and with such a sense of loss. Just astonishing to believe that she's not here with us. I'm also really just thrilled to be in this room and thank Sarah for her gracious words of introduction, our friend Steve for his gracious words of introduction, Lisa Schneider, friend, former student, for all the work that she has done to make this possible. This has been, believe it or not, years in the planning, interrupted only by a global pandemic. But I'm so delighted that we are actually here together to talk about what, to us at least, is a fascinating subject, Kiryas Joel, New York. I should say it's a gesture of great magnanimity for you to have me from cross town. It should be acknowledged. But in fact, the book that we're going to talk about is the result of a partnership between USC and UCLA. And I think it bespeaks the potential that inheres in that partnership now and into the future. So what we want to talk to you about is the book that we have written, which took more than 15 years of research, and that really reflects a dual set of lenses that we use to observe the phenomenon. The lens of Jewish history, which is my discipline, and the lens of American law and politics, which Nomi has expertise over. And what we arrived at over the course of our research is a somewhat counterintuitive proposition, which is to say that the phenomenon of Kiryas Joel is almost without precedent in the annals of the Jews in the modern world, whereas this shtetl, as it imagines itself, is in fact, in some very important ways, at home on the landscape and soil of the United States of America. And so we want to share with you the ways in which we observe the phenomenon and how it's both unprecedented and has ample precedent in multiple ways. So let's begin with the title, which we're going to try to unpack over the course of our time, and we'll spend a half hour or so just laying out the basic premise, and then we'll have a conversation with Sarah and then open up for discussion. So I'm going to focus on the part of the title, the latter part of the title, Shtetl, which is the name that the founders of the community gave to Kiryas Joel, which is a legally recognized municipality comprised almost entirely of Hasidim from the Satmar dynasty in Orange County, New York. At one point, Kiryas Joel was a neighborhood, and then it became an officially recognized village with the town of Monroe, but from the year 2019, it seceded from the town of Monroe and became its own town as well, called Palm Tree, which is the Yiddish, the English translation of the name Teitelbaum, which we will get to in just a minute. And what characterizes this community, which is a legally recognized municipality, is the extraordinary degree of homogeneity within it. As I said, almost all of the residents, with a handful of exceptions, are Satmar Hasidim, and the entire community really adheres to a single way of life, ritually and culturally. And at the same time, by virtue of the fact that it was incorporated as a legally recognized village in 1977, the leadership of the community also exercises a tremendous degree of political authority over the residents of the town. And in some, in an important way, you have two overlapping sets of authority structures. You have a religious authority structure and you have a political authority structure. And the two are in many respects seamlessly, or some would say terrifyingly, interlacing with one another. To give you a sense of what is distinctive about this community, as you enter the community, you will encounter, depending on what your point of entry is, the sign that you see in the top right, which encourages and indeed even admonishes people coming to the community to adhere to the norms of modesty that are reflective of the values of the community. So that is to say, one should dress and speak in ways that reflect the value set of those in the community. This idea of creating a self-contained spiritual enclave at a remove from the teeming seductions and allures of a major urban environment, this idea has been a long-standing aspiration of many, but has been realized, I would say, in very few places, in the way that it has in Kiryas Joel, which is to say the fusion of the religious and the political. But in imagining what the community could be like, the original formulators had in mind the simple ambition of creating a shtetl. And what they had in mind was a wholly insular, self-contained, homogeneous group of people marching in a certain sense to the same cultural beat. And what I want to call our attention to here is the way in which that image of the shtetl was very much at odds with the actual shtetl that existed on the soil of Eastern Europe. The shtetl of Eastern Europe, the actual historical shtetl, was oftentimes a neighborhood or even a portion of a town which contained a large number of Jews who might represent a considerable plurality or even a majority within a larger area that included non-Jews as well, but was marked by a relatively large degree of religious and ideological heterogeneity, not homogeneity. That is to say, not everybody was traditionally observant, not everybody belonged to the same political party. There was a tremendous amount of diversity and cultural energy animated by that diversity within within the Eastern European shtetl. What Kiryas Joel represents is a kind of mythic ideal at odds with the historical shtetl. It hews more to the idea of the shtetl as it emerges in sort of classic Yiddish literature or even in the wildly popular Fiddler on the Roof, which in its early stages really captured that idea of a wholly contained community until it no longer was. But it's important to note, Kiryas Joel really seeks to be a mythic shtetl that bore very little resemblance to the community whence Satmar Hasidim came, which is to say from Satu Mari, Romania, before 1920, Satmar, Hungary, in the northeast quadrant of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which was a small east-central European city marked by multi-ethnic, multicultural, multilingual identities, of which about 15,000 of the town's population of 50,000 were Jews. And we see, if you read the Yiskerbuch of Satu Mari, you'll see a spectacular array of distinct Jewish ideologies present within the community, far from the degree of homogeneity that we see in Kiryas Joel. So this is one very interesting way in which Kiryas Joel really stands apart from the actual lived experience of Eastern European Jewry as it emerged over the course of the 18th and 19th centuries. The animating force of the Satmar Hasidic group, and really one of the main figures in what is known as Haredi Judaism, otherwise translated as traditionalist or ultra-Orthodox Judaism, is this person, Rabbi Joel Teitelbaum, scion of one of the most renowned and notorious Hasidic families to take rise in this fascinating laboratory of countervailing religious currents that was Hungary in the East, in what is known as the Hungarian Unterland. Reb Joelish, as he was known, bore the family trait of an extreme combativeness on behalf of a pure Torah, true Judaism. He's deeply committed to upholding the sanctity and purity of the Torah as he understood it. And if this entailed combat, he was more than willing to engage in it. That combativeness was indeed a hallmark of the Teitel family from its inception in Hungary in the early 19th century. He fiercely opposed all forms of innovation, as he understood that, understood them, including and especially Zionism. And in fact, Reb Joelish was known as one of the most forceful Jewish anti-Zionists of the 20th century. He famously described Zionism as the chief form of spiritual pollution that the world had seen. It's important to note that he had many other targets of his enmity, but this was one of his, perhaps his most most important source of opposition. Ironically enough, Reb Joelish was himself saved from the ravages of the Holocaust by a Hungarian Zionist official by the name of Rudolf Kastner in a famous, infamous episode, depending on your perspective. However, it's important to note that he made his way from sort of the rural towns in East Central Europe to what was then Romanian Satu Mari in 1928, was elected town rabbi. Because of the opposition to him, which emerged from his opposition to so many others, he was actually encouraged to stay away from Satu Mari for 6 years. He returned in 1934. He built up his community for only 10 years in Europe. Then, shockingly, on March 19th, 1944, Nazi German forces invaded Hungary, thereby breaking the alliance, but what had been reverted to Hungary, breaking the alliance that Hitler had with the Hungarian leader Adolf Horthy, the overwhelming majority of the Jews of Satu-Mari and surrounding regions were sent off to concentration and death camps. Reb Yolish was saved. He was saved in a curious way, sent off to, with 1,684 other Jews, to the concentration camp Bergen-Belsen, where he and they were incarcerated for 6 months. Then they made their way, were liberated in early December 1944, went to Switzerland, from there to, ironically enough, Palestine for about a year, and then to the United States in 1946. And in 1946, Reb Yolish arrives in the United States and begins to build up a community anew out of the tattered fragments of European and especially Hungarian survivors. From his earliest days in the United States, he happens onto the realization that it's going to be essential to create what he regarded as a shtetl, at a remove from the city, that could serve as a place of refuge for his Hasidim in two regards, a place of cultural refuge and also a place where more affordable housing could be had. And therein lay the genesis of the idea of creating a shtetl, as he and his colleagues imagined it. It took decades before his chief aides could find land outside of New York City that whose residents would be willing to sell it to a group of Hasidic Jews, and we can explore how that land transaction went down. But in 1972, land was purchased in the town of Monroe. 2 years later, after the land was developed, the first residents from Brooklyn associated with the Satmar group made their way to Kiryas Joel. And in 1977, a village of Kiryas Joel is created. This followed 2 years of very intense tensions and disagreements with the town officials and residents of Monroe, principally over zoning issues, that prompted this solution that a village of Kiryas Joel, village of Joel, should be created so as to afford the Satmar Hasidim control over their zoning regulations. In many respects, Kiryas Joel, as it takes rise, beginning in 1977, has been a staggering success, certainly in demographic terms. It is a community that, because of the very large birth rate of the community, grows at a very, very quick pace. It essentially doubles in population or thereabouts almost every decade, as you can see in this slide. And estimates are that by the year 2035, it may have over 70,000 residents. Some estimates are even higher. So its population growth is certainly a measure of success. The homogeneity of the community, it's almost entirely Satmar Hasidim, is in the eyes of the community residents itself a great source of success. One of the markers of that homogeneity is the fact that it is a Yiddish-speaking community from cradle to grave. You walk the streets of Kiryas Joel, you will hear Yiddish spoken. In stores, Yiddish is spoken. In schools, Yiddish is spoken. This bespeaks this commitment to hold on to the community's cultural and religious norms. Education is taken extremely seriously, and in fact, it's one of the most important areas of focus, of investment in the community. But very few of the residents of the community make their way out to secular educational institutions. Almost everyone attends traditional Jewish educational institutions, cheders and yeshivas. The community operates according to the modesty norms that Reb Yolish has had set down as fundamental to his version of Judaism. And another marker of success is the fact that this is a community that has carved out a very large degree of what we might call local sovereignty by virtue of the fact that it is an officially recognized community according to the state of New York. So there are many markers of success of this vision, especially as it made a transition from being a shtetl to a village. And yet at the same time, and with this I'll conclude, there are also very clear traces of trouble in the shtetl, tsuris in the shtetl, we might say, much of which began after the death of Reb Yolish, the great charismatic founding rabbi, in 1977. Because there was no clear plan for succession. He had no male heirs. His three daughters predeceased him. And almost from the beginning, there were tensions when his nephew, Reb Moshe, assumed the mantle of leader of the Satmar community. Amongst those who opposed Reb Moshe was the widow of Rabbi Joel, Alta Feige, who had a serious beef with Reb Moshe, and who attracted to her a circle of followers who became a group known as the Benayol, the children of Joel, imagining themselves to be the truest followers of Rabbi Joel Teitelbaum. Years later, this tension would develop into an even fiercer and more ossified split between two sons of Rabbi Moshe, Reb Aaron Teitelbaum, now located in Kiryas Joel, and Reb Zalman Leib, in the other major center of Satmar settlement in the United States and in the world, in Williamsburg. So division has been really endemic to the community, certainly since the death of Reb Yolish. There are many other circles of enmity and strife that have divided the community, both within and with its surrounding neighbors. And one of the ways in which that that enmity and strife has been manifested is in a constant debate over the legality of a public school in Kiryas Joel, which is one of the ways in which this community has manifested itself as a decidedly American community. And with that, I'm going to hand things over to Nomi to continue, and we will pick up from there. I think it's there, yeah.
Hello, everyone. First of all, David, you have my permission to try to signal me at 15 minutes if I haven't wrapped up. I also really want to echo both David's words of thanks and memory of Sharon Gillerman. That really rocked me a little to realize that we are the first people to speak after Sharon. So as David said, I am going to talk about the Americanness of the shtetl. And there are many ways, too many ways, more than I can address in these opening remarks, in which this village, seemingly so un-American, seemingly so at odds with American values, possibly, according to some, like those who spent a decade suing, contesting the constitutionality of the public school district in Kiryas Joel, there's a strong sense that this is a very un-American phenomenon. But there are so many ways in which it is so deeply American. We could talk, as David already alluded to, about the long history of religious experimentation and diversity and the establishment of religious enclave societies into which this village so quite perfectly fits. We could talk about the ways in which the Satmars have learned and very quickly came to play the game of American interest group politics. Particularly their highly effective deployment of the block vote. We could talk very interestingly, and this is really the backdrop to the story of the establishment of a public school in the village of Kiryas Joel. We could talk about the rise of a disability rights consciousness inside the Satmar community. We could talk about the influence of the internet, which is at once proscribed and yet widely used. But what I want to emphasize in these remarks is the way in which American law penetrates, defines this community. Now, when we talk about law, oftentimes what people first think of is what we lawyers call public law. That is to say, the law that governs public institutions, first and foremost governmental entities like the village or the public school district or a state or other public entities, not necessarily governmental in nature, public accommodations. So constitutional law is primarily, if not exclusively, addressed to how power is exercised by public entities. We also tend to think of courtroom battles, right? Where is law in the courtroom? And there's plenty of public law and there's plenty of courtroom battles in the story of Kiryas Joel, and much of the book describes that. But I want to call attention, if we really want to understand what makes this community so American, we have to pay attention to the less visible, but in some ways more significant, more primary role that's played by what we call private law. That is to say, the various bodies of law, of American law, that govern private actors and private activities, like private property law, the laws that govern real estate transactions, the laws that govern businesses, laws that govern private corporations, both for-profit businesses and nonprofit corporations, like religious congregations, the law that governs family relations, which are deemed to be private relations. Now, all of that private law also, quite often, is the subject of courtroom battles, and there have been plenty of private law courtroom battles that also have been a prominent feature of life in Kiryas Joel. But private law plays an even more pervasive, powerful, albeit invisible, role outside the context of litigation. Private law has played two related but distinct roles that have been of critical importance to the establishment and the ongoing existence of Kiryas Joel. First, it enabled the transformation of the shtetl, which was originally, as David said, just a group of Satmars living in a neighborhood of the town of Monroe. It enabled the transformation of that private association, just a group of private property owners and renters, into a public entity, right? The village. So that's one important role played by private property law. And second, of equal importance, once the village was established, private law and the very distinction that American law draws and is so deeply committed to between the private realm and the public realm has played a critically important role in justifying and, as it were, alibying the secular character of the community's public municipal institutions. So let me just try to make that point a little more concrete. As David has already alluded to, the town begins with the ultimate free market act of acquiring land, the purchase of land in the town of Monroe. And it's only once a sufficient number, and all it takes under the laws of New York is 500 residents, they can then vote to establish their own village as a subunit of the village. So this is what we call the private pathway to the creation of a public square, and some might say to the creation of a religious establishment. Let me make that, and this is a slightly insane slide, so bear with me. Let me try to make this a little bit more concrete. I tried to animate this slide. And if I had succeeded, this slide initially would be completely empty, except for the top, where you see the town of Monroe, you see the Monroe-Woodbury Public School District. These are public entities that pre-exist the arrival of the Satmars. And everything else, this would be an empty screen initially because this would be unsettled land, undeveloped land in the town of Monroe. And the first thing that would show up, that would pop up, is what you see in the left-hand bottom corner of your screen. It's a development company, right? It's the purchasing agent that purchases the land in this one little area of the town of Monroe, and the development company does what development companies do. Having bought the land, it subdivides the land, it builds housing, and then it sells the land. I would now be, if I had succeeded in animating this slide, popping all the little squares you see at the very bottom. Those are owners and renters who have bought or rented and moved into all of the property that is actually being continuously developed to support this burgeoning population. The development company is also providing land for other important, from the standpoint of American law, private institutions, the cemetery that you see at the very bottom left-hand corner of the screen, the synagogue, the congregation. Land is necessary, is provided by private entities to build the synagogue. The synagogue itself is it's a corporation. The synagogue is officially, it's a congregation that is incorporated under the laws of the state of New York that govern nonprofit and religious corporations. So too, moving to the right-hand part of the slide, you can see not long after enough of the new arrivals have settled, they set about building, constructing, and using a boys' school, a yeshiva, a girls' school. These are all, from the standpoint of American law, private entities, as are there many other private associations, offshoots of the congregation. David talked about the modesty norms. Well, who enforces the modesty norms? There's a modesty committee, which you can see floating about in between the synagogue and the yeshiva. There's also a village committee, is the translation of Vad HaKirya, a really perhaps the most important entity in many respects in the village. That is, again, nominally a private institution. It's actually not clear if there's any distinction between this Vad HaKirya, which means town committee, which is private. Maybe it is the development company, which is responsible not only for acquiring but allocating land. They certainly have the same overlapping personnel. So you see quite quickly how underneath the line, that's sort of representing the private domain, this gets filled in. And it's only after the community in its private guise is assembled that we then see the creation of the village, right? This is at the very top, on the top left-hand corner, the village of Kiryas Joel, consisting of a village board of trustees, a mayor, a deputy mayor. The village eventually does what most municipalities do. It creates things like a building department to enforce its building code and other typical agencies. There's also in the picture, if you want to round out the picture of all of the different public and private institutions, there's a public housing authority, which is a sort of part federal but part local institution. Eventually, as David has said, we see the creation of a public school district in Kiryas Joel. What I want to call attention to is to sort of try to put a face on these institutions. If we go looking beneath the line, right, at the top, at the sort of tippity top of the leadership structure is the Rebbe. This is the new Rebbe after 79, Moshe, who actually is based in Williamsburg. In the mid-80s, he appoints his son, Aaron to be the chief rabbi just of Kiryas Joel, right? So right underneath there, who's in charge of the congregation? Well, the chief rabbi, Aaron, who also occupies the position as what they call the Rosh Yeshiva, the head of the school system. But there are also lay leaders who play extremely important roles. In conformity with the requirements of the laws that govern nonprofit and religious corporations, the congregation, you're all familiar with these structures and rules. They elect a board. There's an elected board. There's a president of the board. There's a vice president of the board. So they're lay leaders. And one in particular is a man named Abe Weider, who for many years rotates between the position of president and vice president of the synagogue. Abe Weider also, upon the creation of the village, he will be elected to be the deputy mayor of the village. Another man by the name of Leopold Lefkowitz is formerly the mayor, but that's really a titular position. Abe Weider, the same man who alternates between president and vice president of the private congregation, even from the time that he's deputy mayor, from the inception of the birth of Kiryas Joel, he's the boss. In fact, journalists tended to quip. They referred to deputy mayor now for many, many decades, really, Mayor Weider as Boss Weider. Who's running the development company? A fellow by the name of Meyer Hirsch. Who's Meyer Hirsch? Well, for one thing, he's a cousin, am I right, of the village clerk, uncle of the village clerk. He's a very powerful businessman, benefactor, private benefactor of the community, runs the development company, runs the Vod HaKirya, which, as I said, maybe are one and the same. It's a rather shadowy organization, plays a leading role in determining how housing, how private housing is distributed. He's also on the Public Housing Authority, so he's also in charge of determining how public housing is distributed and how subsidies for housing are distributed. When the village gets around to creating a building department, who's running it? Meyer Hirsch. So you can see, and this is why you may see that the bubble, the Vod HaKirya, seems to be maybe crossing the line between the nominally private and public domain. There's a lot, as David said earlier, of the blurring of the boundaries between public and private. So from a legal standpoint, all of the entities below the line are private. But from the internal standpoint of the Satmars, all of these nominally private, legally private institutions, the congregation, the shuls, the schools, the mikvahs, the cemetery, these are, from their standpoint, public institutions. And indeed, even from the standpoint of American law, many of these institutions are contracted with or consulted by the local government authorities, the town officials, oftentimes they run the two, in ways that even American law would characterize as rendering them, let's say, quasi-public. So it is this blurring of the boundaries that has raised questions about the constitutionality of the public municipal institutions in Kiryas Joel. And that has led to some very interesting litigation. Here you can just see that the different characters who wear many different hats. But I will just wrap up by referring to these are just two of literally dozens of lawsuits that have involved challenges to the constitutionality of the village's municipal institutions. First, this is just one of, I think, at least 10 lawsuits brought not by outsiders, but by the dissidents David referred to inside the village of Kiryas Joel, suing the village, claiming that the village, number one, it begins with, it all emanates from a single zoning dispute, claiming that the denial of a permit to construct, to convert a house to be a grand synagogue for the dissidents, that this was a wrongful denial. More than that, the theory is this is actually just one example of the myriad ways in which the village is discriminating against the dissidents, discriminatory denials of zoning permits, of tax-exempt status, of public housing units, and so on and so forth. But ultimately, the claim that was made in this case and in successive cases, the dissidents, the Sotmers claim, continue to claim, that the village is a theocracy operating in violation of the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment. Now, that claim has never been adjudicated because this case ended in a settlement, and every subsequent effort to make the same claim has been met with the same response from the courts, namely, you settled this case, you don't get to relitigate it. The other case, and with this I'll wrap up, that challenged the constitutionality of Kiryas Joel's governmental institutions is the case David alluded to before. This case was brought by an outsider, a curious figure by the name of Lewis Grummet, I'd be happy to tell you more about. And this was a case that claimed that the state law that authorized the creation of a separate school district in Kiryas Joel violated the Establishment Clause of the United States. Although the Supreme Court handed down a decision in 1994 seeming to side with the challengers, striking down that original authorizing statute, in fact, this was a truly Pyrrhic victory. Efforts to reauthorize the school district in Kiryas Joel continued, litigation continued for another half a dozen years, and ended with a similar absence of any true adjudication. In point of fact, there's never been a definitive adjudication either of the constitutionality of the school district or of the village itself. Looking back in hindsight, from today's standpoint, we can see this 1994 decision, which was support the case, the village, the defense of the village was supported enthusiastically by the newly ascendant Christian right, which saw this case as an opportune moment to get the Supreme Court to begin to retreat from its, in hindsight, fairly short-lived commitment to a rigorous version, a strict principle of separation between church and state. They didn't succeed in 1994, but in hindsight, for reasons I can explain, or you can read the book to find out, this case turns out to be a turning point and really a midpoint in that effort of the religious right to get the Supreme Court and increasingly conservative Supreme Court to change the way it interprets the First Amendment in a way that, not in 1994, but as of the most recent term, has come very, very close to the ultimate goal of repudiating the principle of separation of church and state. This case played a pivotal role in that campaign. And so what we can see, the story we try to tell in more depth in the book, and we'll have a chance to talk to you more to expand these points more, is that what we see is that the timeline of the formation and the development and the astonishing growth that David described of the village coincides with the ascent of the religious conservative movement. So there's a very interesting relationship about those two phenomena about which we can say more, but it's just one dramatic indication of the ways in which Kiryas Joel, for all of its foreignness, is a community that is unmistakably American.
Thank you so much. That was really interesting. And I want to pick up on what you were talking about at the end to ask you about political contacts and coalitions and political support. And one statistic that really stuck out to me in the book was in the 2016 election, I think it was 55% of Kiryas Joel residents voted for Trump, but in 2020, 99% did. And then I recently read an article that Reb Aaron came out against Trump in after the most recent election, and said, "Why are people supporting these crazy Trumpy people?" And attributed that to the internet, which is ironic because it was posted on the Satmar Twitter feed. And so I was wondering if you could address all of these things and also how you see this playing out today and possibly in the future.
Yeah. Okay, I'll take a crack at it. What is characteristic of the Satmar brand of Hasidism and what helps explain the fact that it has become the largest Hasidic group in the world is its commitment to political engagement, which was present already in the old country, already in Romania. And we talk about the ways in which Satmar really developed the medieval practice of shtadanut, of appointing a designated intercessor to be the representative of the community with the local secular authorities. That's a tradition that Satmar brought over to the United States. And really from the first days of Reb Yolish's presence on American soil, his chief aides were establishing contacts with local and state officials in New York, with remarkable alacrity. In doing so, I would say that there was a sense, a kind of an appreciation that this is the way it's played in the United States. There was a sense that this is the way the political game is played. And there's also a sense, especially after the grievous losses suffered by the community, that Satmar Hasidim were in some sense entitled to receive the benefits of what they regarded as, they say to this day, a malchus shel chesed, a kingdom of grace. The United States was different than any other diaspora community or diaspora sovereign that Jews had encountered, certainly in the modern age. So there is this tradition of political engagement. It develops over time into the remarkably successful deployment of the block vote in places like Williamsburg and Kiryas Joel, where it turns out, in a world of sort of micro-voting, 10,000 votes or 15,000 votes can be absolutely dispositive, such that there is not an election in the state of New York in which the major candidates do not make their way to both Williamsburg and Kiryas Joel to meet with and seek the endorsement of Reb Aaron or Reb Zalman Leib. They, with sort of the a single proclamation, can get all of their supporters out to support to vote for a particular candidate. The sort of eternal question that we've been asking is, when will the day come when the divisions within the community will mitigate the impact of the block vote? It's already begun to happen, but in a certain sense, the news hasn't arrived to state officials. What was present throughout the growth of a Satmar political power is what I would call a transactional pragmatism. Satmar Hasidim generally cared much more about local than national elections. They cared about politicians who could provide benefit to their community. Not, it's important to note, by applying illegal pressure, by playing the game of American interest group politics and doing it very well. What captures our attention is this intriguing shift from 2016 to 2020 at the presidential level, when the community undergoes what would seem a dramatic transformation, right? Somewhere between 53 and 55% vote for Trump in 2016, in 2020, 99%. So it would seem on the face of it as if that transactional pragmatism has given way to a new ideological conservatism that is of a piece with the rise of a powerful white Christian religious conservatism in America. And there are many reasons to believe that that alliance has been forged. We think that's a bit too facile of a conclusion, and it must. We have to analyze longer trend terms for a longer period of time. What is clear is that there are all sorts of local and very specific reasons why Hasidim and Sabra Hasidim voted for Trump in the numbers they did in 2020. It has a lot to do with his commitment to prison reform, his commutation of the sentence of Shalom Rubashkin, Hasid from a different community, but someone whose cause they took on as a case of Pidyon Shvuim, the liberation of prisoners, a classic, vaunted Jewish practice. So what is clearly the case is that there is a tremendous amount of accommodation to the political system in the United States. There are traces of a Satmar political behavior that resemble white Christian conservatism. And the trend lines, as Nomi said, of the growth of this community and the growth of a white conservative religious movement focused on the supremacy of the doctrine of religious liberties. Like, all these things are coinciding. And yet, there still are interesting qualifications that we must offer that suggest that that transactional pragmatism is not fully finished and may well return. One very interesting data point is that in the wake of the tremendous amount of attention that rained down upon the Hasidic community after the New York Times published a massive story on the Hasidic educational institutions receiving huge amounts of public money and kind of outright defying the state education department's substantial equivalency requirements. In the wake of that, there was tremendous rage at state and local politicians, including Governor Hochul, who was just elected for the first time. Reb Zalman Leib endorsed no one. Reb Aaron endorsed Governor Hochul. So it seems as if we have not seen the last of that transactional pragmatism. But I think there's a growing tension as this community both maintains its separateness and becomes more American between that transactional pragmatism and an ideological conservatism.
If I can just add.
Yes.
So just 2 points to add to what David said. One, David began by talking about how there's always been a tradition of political engagement with the Gentile authorities going back to Europe. But it's important to bear in mind that it is political engagement for the sake of maintaining the insularity of the community. As we see this very vividly, that sort of paradoxical combination of elements in the current controversy over the enforcement of secular education laws or lack thereof against yeshivas. And partly that points to the importance of the lay leadership I spoke to. So it's not, right, most of the community is not engaging with the outside world. That's forbidden. So you have this substratum of lay leaders, shtadlanim as they are known, and they engage with outside political authorities or legal institutions so that the rest of the community can really be sheltered and insulated and isolated and not exposed to the outside world. The other point I want to make, the other, I think phrase I want to jump off of that David used is the Satmars, this is very much of a piece with this tradition of political engagement, albeit for the sake of self-isolation, accommodate themselves to the system in which they find themselves. Well, the American political system was undergoing tremendous changes in the period of time in which this post-war community took form. So when the Satmars arrive, it's the beginning and then, and sort of the first barely couple of decades, it's the heyday of, you know, sort of post-war, Cold War era liberalism. When it seems, you know, what is the American way and what do the Sommers understand they have to accommodate themselves to? The American way frowns on segregation, whether it's self-segregation or legally imposed segregation. Separate is inherently unequal. Integration is the watchword of the day. Separation between church and state is the watchword of the day. And that sort of liberal ascendancy remains in place up until, let's say, the end of the 70s. So as the village is being formed, that's the backdrop. That's the culture they understand they need to accommodate to. Now, but it is precisely in this moment that the backlash is beginning, right? And that backlash gradually gains more and more influence. And by the way, it's important to remember that it's not only from the right that this liberal, integrationist, separationist paradigm is being challenged. You're also getting challenges from the left, you know, whether it's, you know, relatively liberal multiculturalism or much more radical forms of separatism, black nationalism, lesbian separatism. So as now, for the most, you know, the Sommers, and especially in their legal battles, find a solidarity. But this is where I think we really want to emphasize the transactional nature of that solidarity, not so much with the lesbian separatists and the black nationalists, although I would say I wouldn't dismiss there being a sort of an affinity and a connection between, say, black power and a sense of a right to Jewish self-empowerment. But we see much more visibly the Christian right organizations, which are forming their own civil rights and civil liberties legal advocacy groups at precisely the point in time, this is the late 80s and 90s, when the legal battles really heat up, when the school district is challenged, and then subsequently the constitutionality of the village is challenged, and they are offering their support. They are filing amicus briefs up the wazoo. And there clearly is, there are some common causes. First and foremost, there's a joint interest in softening, if not altogether dismantling, the wall of separation between church and state in order to legitimize public funding for religious schools. It is really that issue above all others that gets not only groups like the Sommers, but also modern Orthodox organizations to sort of make common cause. But apart from that issue, as David said, there's really not much ideological affinity between the sides. They're not anti-welfare, far from it. They're not libertarian. Except in the last couple of years is we're seeing, especially around this new mantra of religious liberty, perhaps that's beginning to change.
Thanks. So you talked about the educational system a little bit, and I wanted to ask more about that. So clearly there's a lot of Talmud study in the boys' schools, right? Which I wonder if that has an impact on their legal success. And I know that they hire external lawyers, most of whom turn out to be Jewish on both sides, interestingly. And even the superintendent who runs the public school ends up being Jewish. But I wonder, how do they train people for the work that they need to do external to the community and internal to the community? And that could be the legal challenges. And at one point in the book, you say that that they have gotten quite good at the legal challenges that they're waging, but also internal things like construction and city planning, and you mentioned the Shtetl. Is there any kind of training within the community for that? or even making tights, which is something unique to the Satmar community. And so can you say a little bit more about the educational systems and also the language? Because are the schools all in Yiddish, and how do they learn enough English to engage with the outsiders?
Well, many would say they don't, especially boys. After bar mitzvah age, and this is the source of great controversy and contention with New York State authorities and with organizations representing exiters from traditionally observant communities such as Kiryas Joel, there's very little secular education, including English language instruction, which some would say renders boys in particular functionally illiterate in English. The fact of the matter is about a quarter of the population of employed residents of the village stay within the community and work primarily in the biggest employer in town, which is the private education system. A quarter are employed in small businesses around in the community, and around about a quarter commute to the New York area, Brooklyn or Manhattan every day, and then the rest are in sort of in between. There is no vocational education for boys. Girls are given a much larger dose of English language instruction. They are, by the end of their high school times, perfectly fluent in English, and in some sense trained to assume the most common vocations for them, which are serving as teachers in the educational system, or as office managers or office employees in offices in the community, for which they have the requisite computational and linguistic skills. So there's a kind of there is a kind of disconnect between the expectation rooted in Reb Yoelish's insistence that men in the community should work. They should not devote the entirety of their days to studying Gemara. You study in the morning, you study in the evening, and you work in between. But there is no practical vocational education. There's an expectation. And that's why there's a relatively limited swath of employment opportunities open that ranges from small business to construction within the community, but not vocations that would require advanced university training. They are completely outsourced without exception. The person who, in some sense, is the biggest enigma in the community, a person who jokingly says that people think of him as the Robert Moses of Kiryas Joel, is Gedalia Segedin, the village administrator and also the town clerk of the town of Palm Tree, who is completely self-trained but has now the skills of an architect, an urban planner, a sewage expert, a health management CEO. I mean, it turns out he's just a super smart person who, over the course of time, has developed skills that have allowed him to oversee the growth of this community. He has very real challenges every year. He knows that there are, 500 young women graduating from the Beis Ruchel High School. That means I will need 500 apartments, because those young women will be married within, anywhere from 6 to 18 months, and they stay in the community. That's the Satmar way. But he is, he exemplifies that sort of small stratum that nobody spoke of here, of people who acquire expertise outside of their education, which offers absolutely no insight or training in the skills that they will be called upon to do. Things like construction don't require that much book learning. They require on-the-job training, and you do see Satmar Hasidim engage in that text, but not in anything that requires advanced university training.
I want to share an anecdote that I think maybe makes this variety, right? Because David has described everything from a troubling percentage of people who are arguably functionally illiterate in English, albeit not in Yiddish and in the Hebrew schools necessary for Talmud Torah study. But then, you know, Zegedin is hardly alone in being possessed of, you know, an incredible range of talents. And there are many people like that in the village. For reasons that we can explain, if people would like, I did much less field work than David did. But my first field trip, my main goal was to meet with a woman who has emerged as a really significant leader in many capacities. Her name is Malka Silberstein. At the time I was going to meet her, I don't know if she still holds this role, she was head of the girls' school, so an administrator. She was also really the woman, the individual who really was the first advocate for children with special needs that really gave birth to a kind of...
Let me just add, so the public school in Kiryas Joel is a school exclusively for special needs children.
Yeah. So anyway, a very interesting, very formidable, very impressive woman possessed of many skills. My intermediary, the person who served as intermediary for both of us in terms of like, oh, you want to meet this person and I'll set this up, was the superintendent of the public school system. And as David has just said, the impetus for the, because why would the Sommers want a public school, right? They want their kids, they want the boys to go to yeshivas and receive as little secular education as possible. They want the girls to go to religious schools and the female version of religious training in the United States of America, at least up until now, I'm not so sure. Going forward, public schools have to be secular. But it was really all around the issue of education, special educational services for children with special needs, which by law must be provided by public school districts to every single child in their jurisdiction who has special needs, regardless of whether they attend a public school or a private school or are homeschooled. And it is not only publicly administered, it is publicly funded by a combination of federal, state, and local funds. Okay, so that school was created. This is the school that's up on the screen. The school superintendent says to me, oh, you want to meet Malka Silberstein? Come to not the village of Kiryas Joel. We all are going to be attending, what do you call those? You know, when the school is shut, it's like every parent's nightmare because it's teacher education day, or what do we call
professional
that?
Professional development.
Professional development day. Come meet us, you know, in the ballroom, in the Marriott, in, I think it was actually in New Jersey. It was, and why they were all gathered there, one of the leading experts in special ed, the most cutting edge, a person on the faculty of the Harvard School of Education, came for 2 days. He had spent the preceding day in the village talking to parents. And then he was spending the next day in the ballroom of the Marriott talking to all of the staff, the administrators, the teachers, I think also teachers' aides and maybe custodians and drivers. I go to the Marriott, and you know, just looks like a Marriott, looks like the hotel across the street, right? Except I go up, I find the room, and they're already in there. There's an antechamber with a coat rack. I wish I had a picture of it. The coat rack, the top of it, hat, 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 and then long coat. And then I go into the ballroom, and in the middle, right, like here, is the Harvard professor. And over here are all the women. And over there are all the men. And they are gathered together to learn from the Harvard professor of education. So, I mean, I think that kind of addresses your question.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And that really contrasts with the anecdote in the book about that same woman, I think, learning about special education options while she happened to be in the hospital from her hospital roommate.
That was actually
a different woman.
That's a different woman. That was Mrs. Weeder, the wife of the mayor.
Right.
And it's significant that they had a child with significant hearing impairments. And you're referring to, first of all, there's a perception that the Satmars and Hasidim in general, that they had very backwards attitudes towards people with disabilities, and they stigmatized them and locked them away in homes, and when it was a source of shame, and it was regarded literally as a divine stigma. Well, that's true, but so did most of the rest of American society. And the change in attitudes that occurred, the sort of consciousness raising that occurred within the Satmar community, occurred at the exact same time that the disability rights movement was just emerging and beginning to raise consciousness in America more broadly. The law mandating the provision of special education services, which is one of the, not the very first, but one of the first legal victories and political victories of the disability rights movement, that law is not, it's passed in 1975. So that's just 2 years before the village is formed. In the 1980s, when this controversy over what are we going to do about Satmar children with special needs arises, it's very new. Most Americans don't know about it. So it was just a chance encounter on the occasion of a hospital stay that the wife of the mayor learns from her hospital bedmate, and she becomes informed. So there's a learning process. But that learning process was taking place all over America.
Right, but that was before the internet had infiltrated a little bit into Kiryas Joel, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Now, I know there are a lot of questions in the audience, so I'm going to open it up now. So if there are questions, please raise your hand. Yes.
You mentioned that a lot of money came from New York State to help support the education. Does New York State have the right to force them to teach secular subjects like math, English, history?
Does New York State, I'll just repeat the question.
So,
support.
Do you want
to? Why don't you repeat it?
I can repeat the question.
No, he'll repeat it.
Oh, go ahead.
New York State gave a lot of money for the education in Kiryas Joel. Could the state of New York require Kiryas Joel to teach secular subjects like math, history, English, things like that? Mm-hmm.
So do states have the authority to regulate private schools, and in particular, private religious schools? Until today, I would have given you the shortest answer in the world that I've ever given. Yes, of course states have the authority to, and the Supreme Court has said that time and again. There have been numerous Supreme Court cases going back to the 1920s in which at one and the same time, the Supreme Court said that parents have a constitutionally protected right to choose not to send their children to public schools if they prefer to give them a different kind of education, including a religious education. So parents have the right to send their children to private religious schools. Private religious schools have a right to operate. The Supreme Court said that is a constitutionally protected right. When you hear parental rights, but in every single case, there were cases in the 20s, there were cases in the 70s, where the Supreme Court made that declaration, it said, but of course, direct answer to your question, but of course the state has the authority to regulate those schools. Of course the state has the authority to prescribe minimum standards of education that every single private school, secular or religious, must meet. And I would like to be saying, of course, yes, because every single Supreme Court case addressing this issue has said, who could even question that? They say literally no one has questioned that. But today, that proposition is being questioned. And it's being questioned
it's not the people who are really most aggressively, directly challenging the proposition that the state has the right to regulate religious schools. It's a certain wing of the Christian right that believes that religious schools should be completely deregulated in the name of parental rights and religious liberty. And while we're at it, many of them believe that public schools should be abolished. They are abolitionists of public schools.
Before we get there, though, let me just help understand, help explain a little bit. The State Department of Education has issued what it calls substantial equivalency requirements, which all private schools are supposed to adhere to. While there is a legal imperative to adhere to those requirements of the state, what has been absent is political will, plain and simple.
Enforcement.
Which is to say, no New York State politician to this day, or very, very few, has been willing to say, I will insist on the enforcement of the substantial equivalency requirement, because they know that that will mean that they will not be the beneficiaries of political support from the various Hasidic and other, for that matter, other religious groups who support them. I can tell you that after the New York Times piece ran on the 11th of September 2022, there was universal outrage in the Hasidic world at the story, which they believed was an attempt to impugn their way of life. It was really an indication of, you know, just radically different worldviews. The New York Times piece highlighted not only the vast amounts of money that went to the Hasidic school system, but the kind of outrageous defiance of these minimal requirements for English and math. And almost universally, people with whom I spoke in the Hasidic world believe this is, you know, even an anti-Semitic attack, but a vicious attack upon the integrity of their way of life. Now, something is going to have to give. One possibility is the Supreme Court will say, you actually don't have to adhere to any substantial equivalency requirements. You have complete latitude. I think what we're going to see in New York State, however, is going to be a more fractious battle, where state authorities are going to say, no, you can't get the money without some minimal adherence. I think that's going to happen, and that may make its way up to the courts. But it's really been an absence of political will to enforce what the state has the right to enforce.
Okay, let's go back there. And is there a microphone? There we go. Yes, please.
One of the things that I heard after that New York Times article came out on media was the anger of the Hasidic community saying that perhaps we're not educating our students the way you want us to, but in your public schools, you're not educating them at all. And people are graduating from the 12th grade or leaving school in the 11th grade who are barely literate in English, that being their only language. And they're saying, why can you point that finger at us when you're not even doing your job? And that, I think, is something that we're going to have to be able to counter.
Yeah. Well, there are many battle lines in this this theater of war. There are many lines of defense within the Hasidic community, including, look at the results of our educational system. We educate upstanding citizens. The crime rate is, minimal. We are productive workers. We pay taxes. Like, what more do you want from an educational system? And in addition, it allows us to preserve something that's very, very precious to us, that the American system has told us we can preserve, which is our way of life. It is important to note that the chief line of opposition to that argument comes from people who exited that world, who say we have been completely deprived of the capacity to fend for ourselves in the world because of the educational deficiencies. So those are two strands. You've mentioned a third strand. These are all going to be playing out in the state of New York, I would say, over the next 5 years in a very contentious way. And my sense is that we're going to see increasing pressure on Hasidic communities to do what seems to me in retrospect as kind of a moderate on this, to adding several hours a day of, a couple hours a day of English and math is not going to undermine the Satmar way of life. And in fact, when I went back, we were on a panel discussion immediately after this story broke, and I went back and I looked and saw what Reb Yoilish had to say when the first Hasidic school was created, the first Satmar school was created in Williamsburg. And what he said was, our boys, referring to boys because girls get a much heavier dose of English, our boys will learn the English they require in order to work. If you don't want your boy to learn English, go to another school. So it's very interesting to see how the Satmar world has moved substantially to the right. My own sense is a little bit more English and math is not going to upend the whole system and bring down the edifice. So that's where I could
see. I just want to add one thing, Ruth, because the line that you said, right? Well, what about the public schools, the failing public schools, and they're beyond redemption? That is a line literally ripped out. I referred to this new wing, this new abolitionist movement in the Christian right that wants not only total deregulation of private schools, but let's abolish the public school system. That is their line. And I think this is a mimicking of that line, not to say that Somers aren't perfectly capable of having made that observation and come up with that themselves, but to me, this is a pretty vivid example of what looks very new to us, whereas formerly, there were kind of very occasional, intermittent, transactional alliances between the Satmars and the broader Haredi world on the one hand and the Christian right on the other over, we both would like public funding for our religious schools and we both would like the state not to, get too involved in what we do. Now it seems to be much more of an actual absorption of the discourse of this abolitionist, and that was kind of Betsy DeVos's, I think she was representative of that.
Well, this has been a very rich conversation. Thank you so much. I'm going to call Steve Ross back up to take us out, and I recommend that you all purchase the book. It's a great read.
I want to thank our panelists today, David, Nomi, Sarah, and I want to particularly thank all of you for coming to our event. It's a delight to see everybody in person again, and I welcome you to come to meet us online. Our next event is going to be on January 22nd, and it's going to feature Victor Brombert. And if any of you have seen the CBS show 60 Minutes on the Ritchie Boys, Victor at 98 is an emeritus professor at Princeton, still publishing articles, still lively, and is going to talk about his experience as an undercover agent in Europe and his experience as part of the group known as the Ritchie Boys. Thank you, wish you well, and good evening.